Kingdom family, we're currently accepting submissions for our Father's Day celebration video. Show your dad some love by sending in pictures or a video of you saying Happy Father's Day by texting the word videos to 313131. Deadline is Tuesday, June 15th. Let's celebrate Father's Day the Kingdom Fellowship way. Attention all graduating high school seniors. It's time to apply for the Kingdom Fellowship AME Scholarship. Applications are available on our website for all graduating high school seniors who have been active in the church for at least 1 year. Kingdom Fellowship offers scholarships based on academic achievement and financial need. So head to our website, kingdom.global/scholarships, for more information. Don't miss your opportunity to become a Kingdom Scholar.
I feel so filled being in the sanctuary after more than a year. I definitely encourage other people to do this.
The word was awesome, the worship was even more awesome, and I had the most wonderful time ever.
Today was wonderful, we had a wonderful time in the Lord.
It felt great being back in the sanctuary. The word coming from the pastor, the energy that was in the room.
It was a wonderful service. Pastor really, he hit the nail on the head today.
There is nothing. You all remember when you were in the sanctuary and pastor went off on the sermon and you were just standing up and shouting for joy? Well, even though there were only like 20 of us in the room, it was spirit-filled. We lifted the rafters from his sermon today. You actually get a camaraderie, companionship, and the Holy Spirit just ruled that sermon today. And I was glad I was a part of it. And all you have to do is type to 313131 gather and join us next time.
I'm so excited to be back in the sanctuary. Come on back. Come on and join us.
Praise the Lord, Kingdom Fellowship. Is anybody grateful that the Lord woke you up this morning? Old saints used to say, and started me on my way. So we just came to bless God and enjoy our time with Jesus. Because every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. So help me give him glory. Help me praise him. Because he's so good. He's too good. We don't deserve it, but we're still glad that the Lord is blessing. Hallelujah. So we wave our hands and we give the bless God and we thank him for bringing us this far by faith. Hallelujah. Jesus, we reverence you and we give you all the glory because it belongs to you. Hallelujah. We thank you for waking us up this morning. God, we're forever changed in your presence. Have your perfect will and way as we worship before you. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Let the church shout, amen. Hallelujah. Woo, glory to his name. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to your name, God. Mm. Yeah, yeah. Come on, clap your hands. All of my life, come on.
All of my life, I've never known you fail.
You remain the same. Wonderful is
wonderful
your name. Wonderful is your name. All of my life, you remain the same. Wonderful is your name. Listen, you woke me up this morning, you did it for me. Started me on my way. You put food on my table. You brought joy to my day. Oh. Oh, Come on, sing it.
Kingdom Fellowship, family, friends, and guests, we are so excited that you decided to join us today on this glorious second Sunday in June. We're going to ask that if you have not already, invite somebody to worship with you today in any one of our social media platforms, whether it be Facebook or whether it be online on our website or whether it be on YouTube. We are so looking forward to the word today. Pastor Watley has started a new sermon series called Ward Away. We also want to take this time to welcome all of our first-time guests. Listen, y'all, we have people worshiping with us from Texas. We have people worshiping with us from Georgia, Florida, and even Korea. Now, let's go higher in worship through a word of prayer. Our Lord and our God, we thank you, God, for this glorious day that you have given us. God, we enter into your presence today with thanksgiving and with great praise. God, we enter into this worship experience today, Father, with great joy. Wherever we find ourselves, Daddy, in our spectrum of faith today, God, our only intent is to worship you. Our only intent is to give you the glory. So God, have your own way throughout this experience today. Wherever we may be worshiping, fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray now for the preached word that will come forth. We ask, Lord God, for changed hearts and changed minds today. For those of us that might not know you, Lord God, we pray that you would touch us. For those of us, Lord God, that don't have a church home where we're growing, God, please touch us. For those of us, Lord God, that may have slipped back a little this week, God, we pray that you would touch us. Transform us today, God, from the inside out. Then when we leave this worship experience, Daddy, we will be different than the way that we began. So God, in Jesus' name, be glorified in every aspect of this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go. We are kingdom fellowship. We're kingdom focused. We gather to worship the Lord. So glad you chose to join us. Let's grow in the word together. Give our heart to Jesus.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
We are kingdom.
We are kingdom fellowship. We're kingdom focused. We gather to worship the Lord. So glad you chose to join.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go. We are kingdom fellowship. We're kingdom focused. We gather to worship the Lord. So glad you chose to join us. Let's grow. Yeah.
Kingdom family, we are entering into the start of our fourth and last quarter of our Kingdom Builders campaign. This has been an incredible last 18 months. We're surviving, in fact, growing through a pandemic. And our God is demonstrating His power to keep, to heal, to meet needs, to start, and to complete, even in the midst of life's storms. His commitment to us is unfailing. God reminds us that we too should finish what we started. He never asks of us beyond that which He has in fact made available to us in our lives. Kingdom family, we are just over $1 million more to meet and to achieve our goal by the end of this year. We are expected to be in our new sanctuary and base of operations early next year, with substantial completion projected for spring of 2022. So let's continue to pray, to give and commit to the work of kingdom building and completing the work God has before us. Let's get excited about our upcoming Sunday Kingdom Builders celebration on June 27th. After all, we are Kingdom Fellowship. We are Kingdom Builders. And we are Kingdom Focused.
Kingdom Focused. Well, welcome to another opportunity for us to give God praise and give God glory from wherever we are. We thank God for the advent of technology that allows us to be bound together heart to heart and breast to breast. We thank God that God continues to move throughout the kingdom of God and here at Kingdom Fellowship. I am excited, as you might imagine, because we are excited about our fourth quarter for our Kingdom Builders campaign. You already heard Reverend Loxie talk about what we're going to be doing to celebrate, but he left out some vital information. I want to drop it on you now. Not only will we be celebrating what God has done to bring us to this point in our Kingdom Builders campaign, but because it's a celebratory moment, we wanted to do it right. So we're bringing in none other than gospel music artist, Grammy Award winning, Anthony Brown is going to be in the house, and he's going to be sharing his gift of music with us. And we're looking forward to celebrating God together. We're looking forward to finishing strong. As you know, we started this campaign with a $5 million goal, and we had pledges towards that amount, and we're going to be about $1 million left by the time we get to our fourth quarter. So we're right where we want to be. If all of us do our part, we're going to meet our goal to the glory and honor of God. As pastor, I want to thank you for your support, and I want you to make sure that you tune in, because we're going to have, that's right, a celebration. Listen, Father's Day is coming, and I want to make sure that you give your dad a shout out, whether he's here or whether he has transitioned, whether he is your birth father or your spiritual or surrogate father. We want to give dads their props. We want to make sure that we have time to produce it properly. And so please, if you have not already put in your video, your photo, please go ahead and send that in so we can make sure that we include his name as a part of our celebration for Father's Day. We want to ask your prayers for the family of Brother Stephen Martin, who lost his son to COVID. And we know that all loss is tragic, but to lose a child just is unnatural. In fact, our language does not have a word to describe a circumstance when a parent loses a child. So let's go ahead and pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we lift up Brother Martin and his family. We pray, God, that you might grant them a special measure of grace as they send their son to be with you. We pray, God, that as their church family, we might serve as a gird and support to them, and that, God, you might show yourself faithful, mighty, and strong to grant them grace during this season and the days to come. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, my brothers and sisters, in the midst of death, there still is life. We want to encourage you, take advantage of our life groups that are now going into their new semester. Our Grow University is offering classes on the Holy Spirit. And we want to make sure that you are living according to the Spirit, not according to the flesh. So please take advantage of those resources that are available to you. It's time to receive our tithes and offering for today. So grateful to God that we have it to give. I already talked about our Kingdom Builders campaign, but I want to stop and pause and remind you that it's really our tithes that serve as the basis for all that the ministry does here at Kingdom Fellowship. All of the resources resources that you give help us to do all the work of ministry, both within the four walls and outside the walls of the church, even outside of Kingdom Cares. And so I want to thank God for all of our tithers. I want to invite you to become a tither. If you've never done it before, the Bible gives you this opportunity. God says, try me and prove me. See if I won't open the windows of heaven, pour down blessings that you won't have room enough to receive. So I invite you to do that. Finally, big shout out to all of our Kingdom Cares givers. We thank God that now the weather has warmed up. We went from cold to hot. We want to thank God for all those that are continuing to serve faithfully and all those who are considering to sow as well. Let's pray one more time. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you that we have it to give. God, at the beginning of this pandemic, we didn't know what kind of financial shape we were going to be in, but through it all, God, you have made a way and you have supplied our needs. We thank you. And now we pray that you might continue to bless us. Bless those who found themselves particularly challenged financially. Bless those who found themselves abounding and being abundant. God, wherever we are, help us to remember that it's by putting your house first that you promised to take care of our homes. So bless, God, I pray, both gift and giver. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, brothers and sisters, we're excited about this new series called The Waterway. Come on, y'all. Let's have church.
Remember, God cares for you.
This is the day the Lord has made, and we're excited to get into the Word of God. Let's go ahead and go into the Gospel according to John, the 5th chapter, beginning reading at the first verse. John's Gospel, the 5th chapter, beginning reading at the first verse, and there these words are recorded. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the Sheep Gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having 5 porches. In these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, and paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been in that condition a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, but while I am coming, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked. Thus far, the Word of God is the Spirit that speaks, and God does. God, I just want to use as a subject for the next few minutes, walking out of a watery place. Amen. Walking out of a watery place. Amen. Brothers and sisters, last Sunday, I wondered aloud about whether Noah ended up getting drunk after coming out of the ark, after spending more than a year confined, quarantined, if you would. I wondered aloud, was his drunkenness a direct result of the trauma that he experienced while he was on the boat? It's the kind of insight into a text that you only gain through experience, when now you can relate to what you're reading because your own life bears witness to what's going on. And the truth of the matter is, our brothers and sisters, all of us have been traumatized. All of us have experienced both trauma and tragedy during this pandemic. And as a consequence of our COVID season, the issue now is not simply how will we come out. I mean, the issue is not simply where and when will we will choose to wear masks and how we will decide whether we will distance or not. But the truth of the matter is, we have some lingering questions that are going to live after all of the quote unquote regular way of life has come back. Questions about ourselves, questions about life, and if we're honest, some questions about God. Questions about myself, like, what lessons has this season taught me about me? What are my needs and desires? What is my purpose and my passion? What are my faith and my fears? What did I learn about my friends and my family? Questions about life. Like, now that I know how fragile life is, what do I need to reprioritize in terms of the way I was spending my time, my treasure, and even my talent? Questions for God. Like, where was God when we needed him? And how do I believe God for healing when I'm trying to move forward? And it's these last two questions I want to try to wrestle with for the time that remains. Because the truth of the matter is, as people of faith, we don't do God or ourselves any favors to avoid hard questions. But in fact, if we do the work with the Spirit of wrestling with them, we can help those who are alongside of us who may not be as biblically literate or spiritually mature. So let's go ahead and jump right into it. Y'all don't mind, do you? So first question, where was God in the midst of this pandemic? I mean, did God fail his greatest test? After all, when we needed him the most, our lives seemed to be indistinguishable from the non-believers. I mean, it wasn't like the unsaved had to shelter in place while the saints got to go about our daily routine. We prayed and tithed and served and read scripture and then put on our mask and socially distanced and sanitized our hands like everybody else. I mean, as the people of God, it was like we had eyes with no lids. We could not blink to protect ourselves. We could not squint to see our way clear. And we could not close them to close off the horror of the world that we were experiencing. That's how we felt. And if we're honest, that's how many of us still feel. Come on, let's be honest. Let's tell the truth. We watched worship online because neither the pastor nor the church could guarantee our safety. So let's just go ahead and talk about it. Where was God? Well, let me say this. God is where God has always been, on his throne, superintending the affairs of humanity. So let's help to be careful about some things. Whenever we start talking about God, let's not substitute our feelings for faith, particularly faith as presented us through Scripture. Because when you read Scripture, you become clear about some things about life and how God works through life. So the first thing I need you to understand is when it comes to where God was and how God works through a pandemic, I need you to understand that the Bible is not given to us for us to read Scripture as if we're searching through our insurance policy to try to find a clause that we can claim to say we're covered. Because you know how we do. We will take a text out of context and use it as a pretext to support what we want to happen in our lives. But you can't play gotcha with the Word of God. God's Word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path, and therefore it directs us forward no matter what challenges we're facing in life. I want to say it again. I need you to understand that when you start asking, where is God? Don't ask it about how you felt in the situation. Ask about how God reveals himself through his word. Okay, that's kind of esoteric. Let me see if I can make it plain. There are plenty of promises in the word of God, but just because the promises are there, they're universally available, but doesn't mean they're universally applicable. So as an example, in the Old Testament, there are five women who are shown to us who happen to be barren: Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, Hannah, and Samson's mother. Now those are women who were given a promise and saw the power of God made manifest as each of them gave birth. That shows us that God has power to do the supernatural. But what would I look like claiming those women for me as my promise? I mean, God can do anything, but I don't have a womb. That's not gonna work. But I can tell you, as a husband who was praying to become a father, when my wife and I were struggling to become pregnant and went to the doctor who told us that you're not going to be able to have a child, our response to the doctor was, we appreciate your medical opinion, but we believe that God is going to have the last word in this situation. Now we were able to make that statement because we knew the stories of the Word of God. And those passages provided us a path forward to know where God was, even when we could not sense him with our feelings. But we never tried to claim one of those stories to try to corner God into blessing us. Are you with me? And so as we talk about where is God, we also may want to ask the question, where is our faith? Because the truth of the matter is, brothers and sisters, oftentimes when we find ourselves with our backs against the wall, that's the time where God wants to raise up faith in us to show us what he's yet doing in our lives. Truth of the matter is, brothers and sisters, COVID, watch this, brought us closer to every preceding generation of humanity and the vulnerability and fragility that all people that have come before us have had to deal with at greater levels. Think about it. The early Christians had to deal with martyrdom as a reality, and yet they trusted God. But before the kind of peace that we take for granted in 2021, every person on earth lived knowing that empires to the left or the right would regularly invade and oppress and enslave other nations at a whim, and yet they still trusted God. Think about it, crushing droughts and famines, earthquakes, and erupting volcanoes throughout human history have almost wiped entire societies off the face of the planet, and yet those survivors trusted God. Which means that we must be reminded that COVID is not Christianity's first pandemic. And it is far from the worst. Tuberculosis, the Spanish flu, the Black Plague, and yellow fever all robbed the church of the Lord Jesus Christ of large swaths of saints who practiced whatever preventative measures they could in terms of medical intervention, as well as prayer and fasting and trusting and petitioning God to protect them and their families. They lived with faith, and then some died in the faith with the expectation that they would be reunited with their loved ones by faith. Y'all not hearing me? In other words, sound Christian theology holds disease and death in dialectical tension, with physical and spiritual healing being a reality that all of us will face at some point or another and have to trust God when we can't trace God. What's your point? Here's my point. That throughout this pandemic, we learned several things about ourselves, several things about life, and I pray several things about God. Chief of all is that God will not leave us nor forsake us. He never promised us a disease-free life. He never promised us a plague-free life. He never promised us a problem-free life. He promised us that whatever came, he would be with us and he would cover and keep us. And if he did not heal us on here, he'd heal us on the other side. This ain't the gospel for babies. This is the gospel for grown-ups. And I need you to hear this, because what that gives us to understand, my brothers and sisters, simply is this, is that as we move forward, our faith on the other side of the arc of the pandemic ought to be stronger, because now we know for ourselves what God can do. So the first question, where was God? God was right here working it out. And how do you know? Because we're still here. Can I testify? Early on in the pandemic, my grandmother on my father's side, over 90 years old, contracted COVID and had to be hospitalized by herself for over 2 months. When she was checked in, they ran the records to get her medical report and discovered that the last time she was in the hospital was when she had my father. And even though we could not see her and gather around the bedside and pray for her, we prayed where we were, she prayed where she was, and somehow, some way, God brought her through, God brought her out, and she texted me with emojis earlier this week. The truth of the matter is, while many of us lost people close to us, we also saw many more people healed that we prayed for as well. So where does that leave us? I'm glad you asked. That brings it to my second question. How do we believe God for healing on the other side of a pandemic that took many people that we loved? I'm glad you asked. That's the question that we see and deal with in today's text. The Bible says that Jesus arrives at this place we call Bethesda. Y'all ought to know that word. And the Bible says this place had five porches, and amongst those porches were many sick people, the blind, the lame, and the paralyzed. And the word says, watch this, that Jesus arrived there, and he arrived there in this sickened society, because the people had gathered there because there was a belief that there was healing in the water. Now, depending on the version of scripture that you're reading, you will find the verses there, or maybe the verses missing. In the New King James Version, in verse 3 and 4, it tells us the people are gathered there because every now and then an angel would come down and trouble the water. And whenever the person got in first to the water, they would be delivered of their disease. And yet, when you read the New International Version, we are not given verse 3 and 4. It skips the how, it just goes to the what. The Bible says that Jesus arrives there, sees this scene, and focuses his attention, watch this, on who may have been the sickest person in the area. The Bible doesn't give us his name, but shows us his need in description, saying this man had been sick for 38 years. And the word says, without any hesitation, Jesus walks directly up to him and asks him this interesting question: do you want to be made well? Now, have you ever read scripture and say, for real?
Right.
I mean, I'm sitting here in the hospital, already checked in, got the bracelet on, and you're going to ask me. But because you got to trust the master's judgment, notice the response to the question, which probably tells us why he asked it to begin with. That the man says, well, you know what had happened was. Yeah. Every time I try to get down in that water, somebody bogars in front of me and I can't get here. And that's what keep happening to me, Lord. The brother is so caught up in his frustration by not being able to receive that which he desired from God, that he can't even give a straight answer when a straight question is asked to him. And I want you to see this, brothers and sisters, because as we are coming out of COVID, we got to be careful that we don't keep some stuff in us that prevents us from receiving that which God has for us next. So let me point out a couple things and I'll send you on the way. First of all, I want you to notice something that's interesting that helps us to understand how the healing of God works. First of all, notice Jesus didn't heal every sick person he encountered.
That's right.
That's good, God. In other words, healing by itself should not be an assumption of salvation.
My God.
Okay. All right. Watch this. Look at the text. The Bible says you have a lot of sick people here, blind, lame, paralyzed. Only one man gets delivered.
Woo, my God. Yeah.
Which gives me to know that while God can heal me, I should not assume just because I'm saved, he has to heal me. And even if he doesn't heal me, guess what? He's still God, he's still good, and he's still worthy. I lost some amens right there. Because we keep trying to find a faith formula to manipulate God into giving us our miracle. But I would remind you about the experience and the testimony of David as recorded in 2 Samuel, the 12th chapter, wherein it says that David's son had become sick unto death, so much so that David had gone into his room and refused to eat and kept praying and pleading and petitioning God. And for a week, the Bible says that his servants could not get him to respond, get him to eat. And finally, they came in and David noticed on their countenance that something was wrong and realized that his son had died. The Bible says, then David arose, washed himself, changed his clothes, went to the house of God and worshiped. Then the Bible says, David came back to his house, asked for food, and when they gave it to him, he ate. And the word says the servants got confused and said, now, wait a second, David. When your son was alive, you would fast and pray. But now that he's dead, you eat. He said, listen, when my son was alive, I said, who knows whether God will be gracious to me and spare my son. In other words, David said, listen, I have faith in God because I know what God has done in my life. I've seen his miracle working power before. I've seen him perform miracles, so I know he can. So I put myself in a position of faith to believe that he could. Yeah. But even if he didn't, I could not presume that he would just because I wanted him to. Real faith requires that you give God the room to make the call. Jesus didn't heal everybody, which means that healing is not a presumption of salvation. But then secondarily, I want you to see this. Jesus' healing ministry must deal both with faith and fatalism. Faith, somebody say faith.
Faith.
And fatalism.
Fatalism.
See, Jesus' healing ministry requires sometimes faith. And we know that because oftentimes Jesus would come to somebody and ask them a question like, do you believe I'm able to do so? They would say yes, and then he'd bless them. And we also know that faith can be the arbiter of healing because the Bible says when he went back home and he tried to do some miracles there, the Bible says he could do no great works amongst them because of their unbelief. Because a prophet's not without honor except in his own hometown and amongst his kin. I just want to put this in here for free. You should understand that sometimes the people at your address will be the last people to recognize your anointing. Just throwing that in there on the slide. So faith, watch this, has a place to play in our deliverance. But in the text, this brother doesn't seem to demonstrate any faith. Do you want to be made well? What had happened? That ain't faith. And yet, Jesus heals him. Watch this. So that sometimes faith is required and sometimes God blesses just because he's God. You do recall how those men who had a friend who was paralyzed came to bring Jesus, him, and when they got to the house, they couldn't get in the door, couldn't bust through the window. They raised the roof, dropped him down in his midst. And the Bible says when Jesus saw their faith, he healed the man. We don't know if he was saved, knew the Lord, trusted God or not. But when he saw their faith, he got healed. And somebody knows what I'm talking about, because the truth of the matter is God answered the prayer of somebody else in your life at your address. Come on, tell the truth. Somebody prayed for you, had you on their mind, took the time to pray. And aren't you so glad they prayed? So I can't be mad that God doesn't always require faith, because sometimes I'm the one that needs the blessing even though I ain't got the faith for it.
Wow, Jesus.
But hear what I'm not saying. I'm not saying we should then resort into fatalism. You know what fatalism is, right? Whatever it's going to be, going to be. And we saw a lot of people get into this space, particularly toward the time when the vaccines came out, because folks had gotten so confused and they had gotten so fatigued and gotten so worried. They didn't know what to believe. And they just said, whatever going to happen, going to happen. That is not how God has called us to live. God has called us to believe him for the best and accept if the worst happens. I can't put it the right way. Job put it better when he said, should we receive the good at the hand of God and not receive the bad? Job put it better when he said, the Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Your faith is suspect if it only is sure when you get what you want. I'm just trying to say this brother's in a watery place. He's been looking for the water to deliver him. He's been looking for his answer from the angel, and yet he's been in this condition. We don't know how long he's been by the pool, but he knows he's been sick for 38 years. It's clear he's been there for a long time because of the extent of frustration that he expresses. And I've always wondered, man, if you've been there for a while, it seemed like you should have gotten the prime position. That he didn't nobody come and pick you up. You could at least just kind of, you know, make your own way into the pool. He was in a watery place. But watch this. The healing of ministry of Jesus is not in the water. It's in the word. I'm done when I tell you what the text says. The Bible says Jesus looked at the man, asked him, do you want to be made well? He gave the wrong answer, but Jesus blessed him anyway. The Bible says Jesus did not reach out and touch him. This wasn't a TBN miracle. This was Jesus doing what he most does in miracles throughout his ministry. He just said, let me clear my throat. And he spoke this word, rise, take up your mat and walk. That at the end of the day, even though you're not where you need to be, because my nature is good and because you can't predict me, I'm going to show you what I can do even when you're not ready to do what you need to do. I'm going to speak it into your life. Rise, take up your mat and walk. Brothers and sisters, my prayer for you is that on the other side of the pandemic, You have a new and abiding faith in the Word of God. That at the end of the day, you're no longer putting your confidence in the promises of people. You're no longer putting your confidence in the investigation of information, but your hope and your help lies in the Word of God. He spoke the Word, and the thing that He said became manifest right in this presence. He said, stand, take up your mat, and walk. And the Bible says the man stood, took up his mat. Y'all ain't happy. Let me try it again. He said it, and what he said happened. Y'all still not happy? Okay, y'all not into the... Let me go back to the beginning. The Bible says when God got ready to create the world, he did not roll up his sleeves. He did not put up his gloves. He did not grab a hammer. He just spoke and said, let there be. And light was separated from darkness, and water was separated from the land. He spoke, and every creeping thing that crawls upon the face of the earth began to live. What's your point? My point is that because he is his word, when he speaks, he's declaring himself. And when we believe his word, we're allowing him to come into us. I need to know, who am I talking to? Is there anybody here that can admit that through this last year, you've been in a watery place? You've been trying to figure out how you're going to make it, and if God was going to work it out, and whether you're going to make it through. But at the end of the day, brothers and sisters, you got to trust that God is not going to make every day easy. But at the end of the day, you're going to have better than you're going to have bad. That ain't my idea. The songwriter said it like this. I've had some good days, and I've had some hills to climb. I've had some weary days and some sleepless nights. But when I look around and I think things over all of my good days, they outweigh my bad days, and I won't complain. Why? Because God's been good to me. He's opened up doors no man could. Is there anybody that can declare that every day has not been easy, and I had some difficult times, but through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to depend on His word. And I want you to know right now that if you will put your trust in the word of God, it will bring you from a watery place. Come on, stand to your feet all over the sanctuary. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lift your hands, Father, in the name of Jesus. We stand here realizing nothing in our hands can deliver what we need. We don't have the power. We don't have the information. We don't have the resources to equal the challenges that rob us of sleep. But God, according to your word, we trust that with you, all things are possible. And so God, we stand on your promises. And we stand not trying to corner you, but we stand encouraged that what you've done in your word, you can do in our lives. And so in the name of Jesus, I pray for real faith. Yes. Yes. Real faith. Yes. Yes. That is disappointed, sometimes discouraged, yes. But then declares, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Yes. We thank you, God, that to every life you have promised some blessings and some miracles. Yes. And God, if they don't come from the direction and the manner that we anticipated, we're going to thank you for what we have, yes. And depend on you for what we don't. Yes. So now, God, I thank you that not only are you bringing us out, but you're making us whole. You're healing us. Yes. You're getting us a greater understanding of who we are in you, yes. And our understanding of why you've spared us and kept us. So now, God, I pray for the one that doesn't know you as Savior and Lord, that they might surrender their souls to you right now. That they might come to know and have faith that saves them and gives them new and eternal life. I pray, God, for the one that is saved, that they're a Christian, but they are a homeless Christian. God, give them to make a decision today that will cause them to unite with a body of Christ that will allow them to grow into who you want them to be. Pray for the one that's in a backslidden condition, God, that you might reclaim them and restore them in Jesus' name. Somebody say, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, clap your hands, all you people. Clap them loud and clap them fast. We're praising God, believing that you're the one that we're prayed for. We're believing that you are the answer to the prayer. You're going to be saved today. You're going to join the church. You're going to be restored. Just take advantage of the information on the screen. One of our leaders is waiting to connect with you, to show you in the Word of God what salvation is all about, to welcome you into the church, to pray restoration in your life. Here's what I know. As long as you stay in that watery place, life is going to stay like it is. But by the Word of God, healing has come to your house. And all you need to do is follow directions. Stand, take up your mat, and walk. Take out your cell phone, text the number, and be prepared to be blessed. Right now, today, just come. Come on, let's sing that one time all over the house. We're waiting for you. God's waiting for you. Nothing better than knowing Jesus.
He will pick you up and turn your life around.
Hallelujah.
You ought to know him.
Get to know him.
Get to know him.
Right now.
Right now.
Today.
Today.
Just come.
Just come.
Hallelujah. We thank God for the eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have felt. We want to thank God for this time together. Receive now the benediction, grace, peace, and mercy from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Rest and abide now with these your people, both now and forevermore. People of God said amen. Come on, say it again.
Amen.
Say it one more time.
Amen.
Kingdom.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Wow, was that not an amazing word from our pastor? We want to remind you, stay connected with us during this week. We have prayer every day. We have opportunity for you to get connected with Bible study. We also want to remind you, if you have not subscribed, please subscribe to our YouTube channel that you might be able to watch a variety of services on demand. We also want to remind you, stay tuned. Right after this, we're going to share more announcements, how you can get involved, and how you can get connected. But until we are able to see you again, stay kingdom focused.
Kingdom family, we're currently accepting submissions for our Father's Day celebration video. Show your dad some love by sending in pictures or a video of you saying Happy Father's Day by texting the word videos to 313131. Deadline is Tuesday, June 15th. Let's celebrate Father's Day the Kingdom Fellowship way. Attention all graduating high school seniors. It's time to apply for the Kingdom Fellowship AME Scholarship. Applications are available on our website for all graduating high school seniors who have been active in the church for at least 1 year. Kingdom Fellowship offers scholarships based on academic achievement and financial need. So head to our website, kingdom.global/scholarships, for more information. Don't miss your opportunity to become a Kingdom Scholar.
I feel so filled being in the sanctuary after more than a year. I definitely encourage other people to do this.
The word was awesome. The worship was even more awesome. And I had the most wonderful time ever.
Today was wonderful. We had a wonderful time in the Lord.
It felt great being back in the sanctuary. The word coming from the pastor, the energy that was in the room.
It was a wonderful service. Pastor really, he hit the nail on the head today. There is nothing. You all remember when you were in the sanctuary and pastor went off on the sermon and you were just standing up and shouting for joy? Well, even though there were only like 20 of us in the room, it was spirit-filled. We lifted the rafters from his sermon today. You actually get a camaraderie, companionship, and the Holy Spirit just ruled that sermon today. And I was glad I was a part of it. And all you have to do is type to 313131 gather and join us next time.
I'm so excited to be back in the sanctuary. Come on back. Come on, join us.